guys, Merry Christmas. Welcome to Christ, Culture, and Coffee. I'm your host, Robbie Lashua. I'm here with my amazing, jolly, festive co-host.
Oh, wow. That was good.
Thank you. Tyler Hurley. What's up, man?
What is up? We are super excited for this episode today. We're going to be focusing on the real Jesus because the past few episodes, we've talked about counterfeit Jesus. So you guys got to know your stuff.
You got to know your stuff. And we want to talk about the real Jesus because this is a couple days before Christmas.
It is.
And guess what? We're celebrating the real Jesus.
Yeah, that's right.
Yep. So specifically, we want to talk about the virgin birth today, why it's important, and the theology behind why the virgin birth is important.
Yeah, and this is going to be a little bit different, too, than what we've done in years past, because you guys might have known we've done Christmas-type theme episodes for the past 2 years. This one's a little bit different, so you're going to want to make sure you stick around for this, because we got a lot of cool stuff that we're going to unpack here.
Yep, definitely. Well, hey, before we get into talking about the virgin birth and the soul and all of these things, Tyler, you have a coffee tip for us today, a Christmas coffee tip.
Yes, this is why I'm feeling jolly today, Robbie. I have a Christmas coffee tip for everyone. So this is very interesting. It's going to be a Christmas coffee recipe that I'm giving here. So this is the recipe. In a traditional coffee maker, the 12-cup kind, you should add these ingredients along with your freshly ground coffee beans. Don't get pre-ground coffee beans.
No, please don't do that. Why are you drinking it if you're doing that?
Yeah.
Get a grinder, get fresh beans.
Don't be lazy. You want it to be good. Do the work. It's worth it, right. I promise. It's not even that much work. You just press a button and it blends it up,
right? It
takes
an extra 10 seconds.
I know, yeah. So that's what you got to do. You got to take these ingredients, along with your freshly ground coffee beans, you're going to put in 1/4 teaspoon of cloves, 1/2 teaspoon of cinnamon, and then 1 tablespoon of brown sugar.
Oh, interesting.
Yep.
That sounds good.
Now you do that, and that makes the coffee taste very festive and Christmassy because you got that, you know, you got that brown sugar sweetness and the cinnamon and the cloves. Like, it all just blends well together.
Yeah.
I haven't tried this before, but I'm interested. So
it sounds really good. Yeah.
It sounds great.
I want to try that. So you just brew it all together.
Yeah, put it in with your grounds, mix it up together, and then brew it, and it'll come out this Christmas cup of coffee.
Dude, that sounds great. I'm going to try that sometime this week.
I might try it too,
actually. That sounds really good. That's a good tip. Well,
yeah,
if you're
out and about
and you don't want to pay $6 for a Starbucks that has that kind of stuff in it, you could probably make that for about, I don't know, 10 cents. So that's a good way to do it, man.
That's pretty cheap. Yeah. So
cheap.
There you go. That's a coffee tip for today. It's a recipe to make a Christmas cup of coffee.
That's awesome. Well, hey, let's get into the topic of the virgin birth. I'm hoping that people are listening. Now, again, we are releasing this a day early.
This
is coming out. We usually put them up on Thursdays, but this one, as you know, if you're listening today, is coming out on Wednesday, the 23rd, because we figured you're probably going to be pretty busy the 24th.
Yeah.
And if you got some last minute shopping to do on the 23rd, you could turn this on your iPhone and your MP3, whatever.
Yeah, just listen to it in the car while you're driving around. Very easy to do.
So here we go.
This is our early Christmas gift to you guys.
Yeah, free of charge, by the way. Well, hey, speaking free of charge, as we get into this, I do want to mention to everybody that we are now on Patreon because we are looking to expand and to do a lot more with this. And so if you wanted to support us, you don't have to. Obviously, everything we have is free. But if you would like to support us because you found some benefit to this podcast, this ministry, you can go ahead and go to patreon.com/ChristCultureCoffee. And become a Patreon, become a contributor to what we're doing. We have different tiers and different gifts that we give to people in different tiers, coffee mugs, t-shirts, and stickers, and all these things. So go check it out on Patreon. If you want to click in the show notes, it'll be there. It's on all our social media and stuff, but would love for you to do that. And hey, huge shout out to all the people who already have supported us on Patreon. We are so thankful
thank you so much
and for all that you're doing to support what's going on here. Okay, with that said, on to the topic.
Let's keep going. We got this.
All right. So as most of you know, the virgin birth of Jesus is a really huge topic this time of year because it's a huge part of the Christmas story.
Yeah.
Isaiah 7:14 prophesied about the Messiah being born of a virgin. And Luke 1:26-38 and also the account in Matthew speaks of Mary being a virgin. I want to read to you these couple of verses from Luke chapter 1. These are verses 34-35. It says, Mary said to the angel, "How can this be since I am a virgin? The angel answered and said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. And for that reason, the Holy Child shall be called the Son of God." So again,
that's right.
Mary is really confused about, wait, you said I'm going to have a baby, but I'm a virgin. How can that happen? And this verse explicitly says that the Holy Spirit, the overshadowing of the Most High, is going to come upon you and procreate this kid in you. Miraculously.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Not just any common birth here.
No. This is crazy. And she knows how things work because she asks, wait, you have to have sex before you can have a baby. That's how this works. And this is a unique situation. So a lot of people think this is just, you know, folklore, or this is wishful thinking, or it's a copy of pagan myths. There's all these things about it. But as Christians, we should ask the question, why the virgin birth? Why was this? Is it necessary? Was this just a miracle to show Jesus was somebody of importance? Why the virgin birth? So today we're going to talk about the virgin birth of Jesus, specifically in regards to how human souls are created.
Mm-hmm.
So when you talk about human souls, right, human beings are made up of two parts of body and soul, material and immaterial. And how are human souls created? Because we know how human bodies are created.
Yeah, that's the question. It's how is that immaterial part of us created? Where does that come from? Is it direct through God in that moment that we're being physically created, that he implants our soul? Or are we created with our soul at conception? How does this work? Yeah. Like, that's the question. How do we get that immaterial part of us?
And there's a couple of there's two Christian views to this. In Christian history and with verses and scripture references that back it up. And so we want to look at these two different theologies in regards to the human soul. So the first view is what's called creationism. Now, don't mix this up with, you know, young earth creationism, old earth creationism.
Yes.
This isn't about the origins of the universe or how God created things in the beginning.
Yeah, this is creationism in regard to the soul.
Yeah, that's what we're talking about. This is just about the soul, and specifically the transmission of the soul. How do we each get a soul?
Mm-hmm.
So creationism teaches that the human soul is specifically created by God and then sent into the body of a person somewhere between the time of conception and the time of birth.
Yeah, and with that, we have some scripture references that we wanted to share with you guys for this view. A lot of people who believe in creationism when it comes to the soul, they point to Psalm 139, 13 through 14, where it says, "For you formed my inward parts, you knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well." So see, like that knitted me in my mother's womb.
Yeah, God made me. He put me there.
Yeah.
That's the idea here. Now, just full disclosure, I am not a proponent of creationism.
No, and I'm not either. Yeah. I spent a lot of time thinking about this too. And
I don't see it, but you do have to wrestle with these verses. Okay.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
What is Psalm 139 saying? Well, a couple of things. The Psalms are poetic. That's literally what they are, right?
They are.
They're poems. They're songs. So the Psalm is poetic, and I am always a little bit hesitant to develop a theology solely based on a poetic verse.
On something from Psalm.
Yeah. Not to say it's not true, but we got to ask, in the genre, with the imagery, what is it communicating?
Right, yeah.
We know two things about this. Number one, God didn't literally knit David together physically.
Of course, yeah.
There were no knitting needles in his mother's uterus.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure.
And you know
I'm pretty sure.
And most people who read that, they understand that.
Yeah.
They know it's not like that.
But they'll say for the physical, this is allegory.
Of course, yeah.
Well, then why isn't it allegory for the spiritual?
That's a great question.
It is a great question. Mm-hmm. I think that's a big deal. So we know this didn't happen physically, but David is communicating this idea that God knows him intimately. He goes on in this passage to talk about how all the days of his life were written, like God knows them. Prior to this, he's talking about, where can I hide from you? Where can I go from you, from where your presence isn't? The idea is that God knows him intimately. And so I don't think that this verse is what we should hang an entire doctrine on, and again, there's a couple other verses, but this is like the main one people say, see, there it is. God creates the human soul of every individual and places it in them. Well, this verse doesn't even say that.
True.
Right. It doesn't you have to embellish a little bit.
Yeah.
But I do think we can answer it as it is. It's pushing the idea that God intimately knows all of us.
Of course. And now there's other passages out there though that they would point to that
there are
people
yes.
with this view point to, and one of them is Zechariah 12:1, where it says, "The burden of the word of the Lord concerning Israel. Thus declares the Lord, who stretches out the heavens, lays the foundation of the earth, and forms the spirit of man within him." So see that? It says, forms the spirit of man within him. So
you would bring that up, Tyler.
Forms is in it's happening. Yeah, that, right? Yeah.
Well, what does it say? It
Such says, a challenge.
It says, forms the spirit of man within him. There it is, Tyler.
That's it.
Case closed.
We're wrong, Robbie. We need to retract our, opinion. Oh.
No retraction yet. Let me explain why I don't think it means
Let's
that.
Hear it.
Okay. A couple of things. If we take this verse literally, then we have to believe God is still stretching out the heavens, which I got no problem with that.
Sure.
Because we know the universe is still expanding.
Yeah. Yeah.
So God could still be stretching out the heavens. We'd have to, then we'd also want to believe that he's still forming the spirit of men within people.
Mm-hmm.
But the one that's hard for me is we'd have to believe that he's still laying the foundation of the earth.
Yeah, you would have to assume that that's figurative.
Yeah, so, well, because, yeah, we don't think he's laying the foundation of the earth.
Yeah.
There's kind of evidence against that. It's kind of been laid and it's there.
At the very least, maybe he's saying spiritually. But
yeah.
Then in that case, that would prove that the other two things are happening either figuratively or spiritually. So,
yeah, it's kind of a tough one because you'd have to take one literal, one not literal, one literal.
Yeah, and you tend to find that authors don't usually write that way.
Yep. Well, so, and again, if you go back into the Hebrew, it's interesting mm-hmm. because this verse is meant to show the power of God by listing stuff that he has already done.
Yeah, yeah.
And so the ESV, actually, when they translate it, I think they translate this more accurately with the sense of what it means. They translate this passage in Zechariah saying, "Thus declares the Lord, who stretched out the heavens and founded the earth and formed the spirit of man within him."
Mm-hmm.
It's past tense, because that is the emphasis of the passage. It's past tense.
Yeah,
things
so
that
it
already
had already happened.
Did. Yeah, right. And so if he formed the spirit of man within him, well, we know he did that in Adam.
Yeah, so that could be a reference to
Adam. Yeah, not to each individual. And so I don't think Zechariah 12:1 brings us any trouble.
Yeah, okay. Well, then what about Ecclesiastes 12:7?
Oh, here we go.
We're going to talk about this one. This verse states, "The dust returns to the earth as it was, and the spirit returns to God who gave it." Isn't that interesting?
Yeah,
because you could see, yeah, like the components that are in there, it's saying that God gave us the spirit and it's returning to him.
Yep.
So how do we reconcile with that?
Well, it doesn't say God gave each person an individual spirit.
Right.
It says God gave it. The spirit returns to God who gave it.
Who gave the spirit.
It's interesting because the it is singular. It's not plural.
That's true.
Who gave them spirits? It's it. Spirit.
That would have been more. That would have made a lot more sense if that's what they were trying to say.
Exactly. So
yeah.
I think what this is referring to is it's the initial spirit or the initial soul that God first breathed into Adam. So there's no claim in this verse that God is imparting a soul to each and every person at conception or birth.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
It makes perfect sense. And so what's interesting, I would even say that when you look at this, creationism in this sense seems to kind of make God the author of evil.
Sure.
Is what happens. Because many scriptures tell us about God's goodness, holiness, righteousness, and love. Many tell us that God cannot lie and no deceit is found in him.
Mm-hmm.
In the account of creation, everything that God makes, he declares is very good, right?
Every time he makes something, very good. It's good.
Very
it's
good.
It's
yeah,
good.
Yeah, good, good, good,
good,
very
good. Yep.
Mm-hmm. And so the scriptures also tell us that there is no evil in God. So the question we need to ask ourselves with this idea of creationism is, how could a good and loving God create a corrupt and sinful soul?
Well, because we know that we're corrupt, not just physically, but our soul's corrupt. We're sinners. We're
sure,
sinful.
Yeah.
So if God's the one making it, he can't make it bad. So you either have to say he's lying to us and he can make something bad and evil.
Which that would make God evil.
Yeah, which would take away responsibility from me being evil.
It would.
Which is crazy.
Yeah, yeah.
Or we have to say that he doesn't create it evil.
Mm,
okay, yeah. So then where would we go from that position?
Yeah, well, it's interesting because, yeah, we have to, like you said, we have to believe that or that God creates a pure soul in each person that is later corrupted. And so this idea is hard to reconcile when you see passages like Romans 5:12, which states that Adam's sin, death, like sin in death had spread to all mankind.
Yeah. It was Adam's Adam's sin that made death and sin spread.
To us, yeah.
So yeah. So can God? So would God make a pure human soul, place it in fetus Tyler Hurley?
Yeah. Right.
Then the question becomes: what corrupts the good soul?
Yeah. So how can sin be transferred from all mankind if God, who only creates things good, is the creator of each individual soul? Because
yeah,
essentially, what's happening is God's continuously. Adam was the first good soul. Then is what you would have to believe.
Yeah, and it was perfect. It was good.
Which we
Eve
believe
too.
That. We believe that.
Eve, too, when she was created.
Of course, yeah.
They're perfect.
Yeah, and we would believe that. But the problem is if you're going with this creationism view, you have to believe that God is creating evil souls.
Yeah.
Regularly.
Evil souls, or he's creating pure souls that he places in a human fetus that get corrupted somehow.
Yeah, so that's the issue. That's what the biggest problem is with this. So you have to reconcile with that.
Yeah, it seems kind of silly. And so the creationist view, it is a it's a view within Christianity that a lot of people would think, well, of course God creates every soul. And
right.
It's like, I don't know if he does. Mm-hmm. And there's scripture actually to propose the opposite view, which is the traducianism view, which we want to talk about now.
Yeah.
So traducianism, again, not a popular term. You're not going to hear a lot of pastors preaching on this on Sundays.
Right?
Yeah. But it's really important for us theologically, especially when it comes to the virgin birth of Jesus. Traducianism comes from the Latin term traducianus, from the word tradux, which means to transmit or inheritance, all right?
Yeah.
So it's the idea of how the soul was transmitted or inherited. Traducianism claims that human beings have the ability to create human bodies, and they also have the ability to create human souls in procreation. So when a man and a woman are having intercourse and creating a baby, the physical human being is created as well as the immaterial spiritual human being.
Yeah.
It's a one-time thing. And so we want to go through why we believe this from a bunch of different scripture support.
Yeah. So to start off with that, we know Genesis 2:7 records the account of the creation of Adam.
Mm-hmm.
God creates Adam from the dust of the ground and then breathes into him the breath of life, right?
Yes.
And it is then stated that Adam became a living, and I'm going to say this right, nephesh. Is that correct?
Nephesh. That's the Hebrew word.
Nephesh,
living nephesh.
Which means being or soul. So so that's when
soul,
Adam became a living being or soul, nephesh.
So we've got formed from the dust, which is the material.
Yes.
And then God breath, which is the spirit, the immaterial, the
soul. Yes. So that's when the soul was created.
That's when God gave the soul to Adam.
Yeah, exactly. Genesis 2:21-23 records the matter and the manner in which Eve was created, obviously.
Oh, okay. So this is fascinating.
Yeah, this is great. This is great. It states that God caused a deep sleep to come over Adam, after which God took one of Adam's ribs and made Eve. Adam then exclaims, "This is at last the bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man."
Mm-hmm.
Now, what's interesting, the importance of this is that Eve did not have the breath of life breathed into her. Do you guys notice that?
Yeah, it doesn't say that in the scripture.
No,
that God
it doesn't.
Breathed the breath of life into this woman he fashioned.
Exactly. It doesn't. And so
does that mean women don't have souls, Tyler?
I wouldn't say that.
You'll get in trouble with the wife.
Careful
of
now.
Of course not. Of course women have souls. That's crazy. Of course
they
do.
Sometimes I think my wife has more of a soul than I
do. Exactly. I'd agree with that.
Yeah. So
in regards to you.
Sure. Yeah. There we go. Yeah. There we go.
But no, that's true. So Eve has a soul, but God didn't breathe it into her.
Right, yeah. And so that's what's interesting. It wasn't necessary since she was taken out of Adam, who already had the breath of life, which is a soul, right? So it would seem that Eve's soul just derived out of Adam, just as her physical body was.
Mm. So because God took a rib from Adam, maybe he also took soul part from Adam.
Yeah, of course. And you know what? Like when you look at this, it makes sense. That has to be what happened. Because he doesn't, why wouldn't why wouldn't it have said that God then breathed the breath of life into Eve?
Yeah.
Because he didn't.
And if she didn't have, of course Eve had a soul.
Oh, she did.
But
yeah,
if she didn't, she wouldn't be a human being.
No.
She would be, I mean, an animal type thing.
Yeah.
She'd be a physical being without any material. So of course she had a soul, because that's what she is. She's a human.
Yeah, exactly. And 1 Corinthians, I'm going to share another passage. 1 Corinthians 11:8 says, "For man was not made from woman, but woman from man." Right? Mm-hmm. So that kind of supports our idea. The biblical evidence proposes the idea that Eve was made from Adam in her entirety, which includes both body and soul. So it's not just purely a physical being.
Yeah.
Eve was created spiritually from Adam too, like by her soul. She got her soul from Adam.
Yeah. I think that's true, and I think that that's what we can deduce from these scriptures and
Well,
in
it
the
just
Bible.
Makes sense. Yeah.
It does. There's also other reasons to talk about, okay, how is the soul transmitted? So it seems like Adam's or Eve's soul was transmitted to her through Adam. But what is, if you go back to Genesis 1, you remember how God keeps creating, you know, fish, birds, and animals, and insects, and all these things.
Yeah.
And he keeps saying, be fruitful and multiply after your own kind, after your own kind, after your own kind, right? So in Genesis 1:28, it says to human beings, be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and rule over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the sky, and over every living thing that moves on the earth. So in this verse, God is blessing Adam and Eve with the power to reproduce human beings. The first blessing is to have sex and procreate.
Yeah,
right?
That's right.
Right in the very first chapter. So again, it's significant that in all these previous verses, God tells the animals to procreate after their kind.
Mm.
And it talks about how they were created after their own kind, except for Adam and Eve. When God created Adam and Eve, they were created after the image and likeness of God. Right?
Yeah, of course.
That's what it specifically says. We're created in his image and likeness. So because of this, think about it. Because of this, it's very logical to think that Adam and Eve could procreate after their kind. If a fish can procreate after its kind, if a buffalo can procreate after its kind,
of course, yeah.
Wouldn't you conclude human beings can procreate after their kind? And in fact, that's what we see happen. My wife has been pregnant four times, and every time she's given birth to a human being. There wasn't a giraffe that came out of there, no aardvarks, not any amphibious animals.
Yeah.
They're always human beings. Why? Because we procreate after our own kind, right?
Yeah, so I guess, too, in this way, you would have to conclude that God's, like, constantly creating souls and, like, other components in other creatures. You would have to, because that's what it logically concludes.
Because animals have a type of soul. They have a type of immaterial part, decision-making will and an instinct and things. So if God is creating these individual human souls, why wouldn't he be creating individual dog souls or,
that's what you would have to conclude.
Souls? Yeah, you would. But it doesn't seem like that, because he says you have the power to procreate after your own kind, which would include the physical and the immaterial. So I think that human beings have that power to procreate after our own kind, which includes the physical and the soul, the immaterial. In fact, Genesis 5:3 says this, "When Adam had lived 130 years, he fathered a son in his own likeness after his image and named him Seth." So this verse clearly states that Seth was created in the likeness of his dad, Adam, which would include both a body and a soul.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, you're not created in its likeness.
Yeah,
you're different from
that's
it.
That's absolutely right. And then even taking this a step further, we even get the concept from Genesis 2:2, where it says, "By the seventh day, God completed his work, which he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work, which he had done." And so so to kind of provide some support and context to this passage, Wayne Grudem actually has a, I have a quote here that he spoke on for this passage in particular, where he said, "From this verse, it can be assumed that God is still resting from creating. The way in which God seems to usually work is through secondary causations in that he brings about his purposes through human agency."
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah, so, that's a big belief that God rests. He's still at rest. He's not creating more of the universe.
Well, yeah, because we didn't have a follow-up after that. Yeah. So that's
but
that's
he set
last
things.
Thing we were...
He set things in motion.
Oh, of course,
so that they continue.
Exactly. Yeah. And so, however, we don't believe that God's deistic, right? Like, he didn't just set everything in motion and like withdraw himself.
Yeah. So the deism, and just in case anybody doesn't know, deism is a belief that there was a God who created things, and he wound up the clock, but then he took off because he doesn't care.
Yeah.
So
like,
we don't
like
believe
a clock
that.
Maker. That's the idea.
We
that
do
they
believe
get.
He wound up the clock. We
of
do
course,
believe he
yeah.
started everything, but we don't think he took off.
We we think there's
still,
involvement. Yeah.
Yes.
Exactly. And so God didn't. We don't believe in that. In the deistic God. We don't believe in that. God is also sustaining creation. That's what we really hold to. Mm-hmm. And so a miracle by definition, I want to cover this. A miracle by definition is a supernatural event that brings about God's purpose in a manner that is not the normal by laws by which the universe usually functions. And this is why miracles are significant, because they are not common. Mm-hmm. So in the area of miracles, we can see that creation, his creation, while allowing secondary agency to function, is clearly seen throughout the biblical account in miracles.
Yeah, so God is involved in our world, even though he's primarily set it up to function in a system.
Exactly, yeah.
And it's operating and it's running. But he's involved because the Bible tells us that Jesus sustains all things and holds them together.
Yes.
But then also, a miracle is when God interjects into the system and disrupts it or suspends the laws of nature in a specific place.
Yeah,
time,
yeah. And so you see
that's
that there's
what a miracle
clear
is.
Direct involvement.
Mm-hmm. He's not gone. He's still involved.
Exactly.
Yep. Yep. However, the normal way things operate is in this system that he set up.
Of course, yeah. Yep.
And that's what we're saying with the procreation, is that the typical way he does it is he gets the ball rolling and then he lets it flow out of that. And is that what's happening with the human soul?
Well, what would have to be happening it, by the creationist idea is if God is intentionally intervening and like creating the soul every time, then essentially like when God intervenes, we call that a miracle because it's outside the norm.
Yeah.
So God would be literally creating a miracle every time that someone is.
Someone or some animal or a squirrel or.
So you see, God doesn't act this way with miracles and like when he intervenes. Yeah. It's only for specific purposes that are outside the norm.
Yep.
So why would our souls be considered miracles or in that same pattern when it's technically like happening as a norm?
Yeah.
Right?
Yep, I agree. I think that, the big idea is that human beings have the power to procreate human beings physically and spiritually. That is what we're doing, because we're creating people in our image and likeness. God's resting from creation. It makes sense spiritually.
It does.
But now, the big verse that most traditionists will point to and saying, here's where it's at.
Here we go.
Comes from Hebrews 7, verses 9 through 10. And this is what they say. One might even say that Levi himself, who receives tithes, paid tithes through Abraham, because he was still in the loins of his ancestor when Melchizedek met him.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, what in the world is going on here? This is like all these terms and confusion and loins being talked about.
Right.
Okay, what is happening here?
Yeah.
So this is referring back to a story in Genesis chapter 14, verses 17 through 24, when Abraham is meets up with the king of Jerusalem, the king of Salem, and his name is Melchizedek.
Yeah.
And he's a priest of God, and Abram gives a tithe to this priest of God. The writer of Hebrews is pointing out that Levi, who the Levitical priesthood came from later on in history, because the Levites were the priest class, the priest tribe of Israel, he's pointing out that Jesus is a superior priest to the Levites, because Jesus isn't from the Levitical priesthood. He is according to the Melchizedekian priesthood, which is superior by the fact that Abram gave a tithe to Melchizedek. Therefore, Levi, who was in the loins of Abram, gave a tithe to Melchizedek. So he's trying to point out that the Melchizedekian priesthood is superior to the Levitical. But he makes this weird statement that Levi himself paid a tithe to Melchizedek because he was in the loins of his ancestor Abraham. What does that mean? That is a weird, that's weird,
yeah.
Right? Okay, so what we can deduce from this scripture. So Levi is let me remember. Okay, so Abraham has Isaac. Isaac has Jacob. Jacob has 12 sons that become the 12 tribes. So Abram is Levi's great-grandpa.
Yeah.
Right? Because Jacob would be his dad, Isaac would be his grandpa, Abram would be his great-grandpa. So it's saying that Levi was in the loins of his great-grandpa when he gave this tithe. The scripture shows that descendants are somehow present in the bodies of their ancestors in previous generations.
Yeah, that's what it would imply.
That's the whole argument's based on that. The other thing about this argument in Hebrews 7 is that it doesn't make an impact if it's only talking about physically Levi was there in some way in previous generations. Because I think it's also talking about his soul was back then, not him personally, he wasn't created yet, but it was going to be transmitted to him because you have your will and volition in the decision-making to pay a tithe, right? Mm. So it's a weird passage for sure, but it's claiming that Levi was in the loins of his great-grandpa when he paid a tithe. How is that possible unless the spirit or the soul of a human being is transmitted to each generation from the previous, from the father?
It's crazy. Yeah.
It makes a lot of sense to me. And it also makes sense that we can procreate according to our own kind. It also makes sense that we can procreate according to our image and likeness. Mm-hmm. It also makes sense that if I'm made in the image and likeness of God, and he could create in his image and likeness, I probably could too in some sense.
Yeah.
And that's why my kids look like me. But unfortunately, that's also why they act like me, right? Because there's the immaterial part to them. So there's whole bunch that comes with this idea of transmission of the soul. The parents create the soul when they create the physical body.
Yeah, there's so much that this implies. I mean, we even see things that it disproves too, like these.
Yeah, if this is true, there's some really important things that we can counteract apologetically.
Yeah, exactly. Like, for example, we talked about this earlier too in past episode. It disproves the LDS belief of pre-existence of Mormons, like of people's souls.
Yeah, Mormons believe that souls pre-exist in eternity.
That they were created before.
What do they call it? The first estate? The first...
I'm not sure, to be honest with you. Yeah. I think I know what you're getting at, but I'm not remembering the term they use.
I think it's called the first estate is what they call that.
I think
that
you're right.
All souls were created way back, and then they're placed in bodies.
Yeah. And so, if this is true, theologically, then that's not accurate. So, and then it also disproves the belief in reincarnation, which there's tons of belief systems that falls under.
Because you have to believe that there's souls existing that die in a human body and then come back in a different body.
Yeah.
We don't believe that souls are pre-existing. They're created when the body's created.
Right. And then this also adds weight to certain issues too, like premarital sex, because then in that case, if you got to think like, hey, wait a second, if we're having sex here and we're potentially creating an eternal soul, that's that's a really big deal.
Yeah, that's a really big deal. I time I gave a sex talk to the high school group I was the youth pastor at.
Oh,
and it was on this, and that was my main point, is you really should think about having premarital sex. I wouldn't do it because it's against the Bible, and there's a lot of other reasons not to. But one of the reasons is because you could potentially be creating a soul that will last for eternity, either in heaven or hell, and that's a huge responsibility on you.
Yeah.
And if you think about it, it's like, wait, what am I doing? And again, hopefully just creating a kid when we don't think that deep about it should be.
Yeah.
But sometimes you got to spell it out for teenagers.
Well, you do. Yeah, it's true. And that's just the fact. So, and with that too, you even see it like today, like we're focusing on the importance of this regarding to the virgin birth. But also I wanted to point out one more thing is when it comes to abortion, even this would also imply that life begins at conception.
The soul
begins at conception, because if we see scientific evidence, and we've talked about this through apologetics and like past episodes, that human being is a person at the moment of conception.
Yeah.
So if that's the case, it in these theological implications would conclude that the soul is created at conception as well.
And you can't kill it. Whereas if you believed in creationism, you have to ask the question, when does God put the soul into a human being?
Yeah, exactly.
And does he do it in the first trimester at conception, in the second trimester, in the third trimester?
up until birth.
Because you that's could the believe thing. You could be a creationist and believe that it's not a person. That the fetus yes. isn't a person because God hasn't placed a soul in him yet.
That's the big issue with this. Yeah. And we obviously know like through this, like that's just not the case. Like a human being is a person yeah. at the moment of conception. And so that's just one of the bigger kind of things that this counter argues against.
Yeah. What if I just thought of this. Okay, so what if we say we believe in the creationist view, but God doesn't impart the soul into the baby until birth? Then do preemies not have a soul? do you see all the yeah, crazy implications yeah. from it? You have
say,
to
no. They're born. That's it.
Yeah. Well,
when they magically leave the womb, all of a sudden there's a soul.
Do C-sections count? I mean, it gets weird. Yeah. What if they're only 24 weeks? Right. You get into that stuff where I think that from the pro-life argument that Christians always make is that they're a human being from the moment of conception. Mm-hmm. Which means that the soul is part of the body at the moment of conception, which lends itself more, I think, to the traditionism view.
Yeah, and I think that hopefully, like, for the Christians who maybe have this idea of creationism or those of you listening, think about that, really. Like, if you were pro-life and you believe that the unborn is a human being at the moment of conception, you got to be consistent and believe that also the soul is there, because otherwise it's not really a human being. So
now you could believe that God places the soul into the body at the moment of conception.
Sure.
But you still got all these other problems of how does that soul get corrupted?
Exactly.
Is that created good? And mm-hmm. there's a lot of other issues.
But still, we just wanted to point that out because it's a very big theological implication.
Yeah, there's a lot that comes from this. It does sound kind of like a crazy idea, but then you start thinking about it, you're like, oh man, what I believe on this actually matters.
It does. Yeah. It really does. And so, and then we're going to turn this back around now to the virgin birth, right?
Yes.
So the virgin birth potentially protects Christ's sinlessness. Now,
this is huge.
If you believe in this idea. Now, Robbie, if you want to elaborate more on that, it's really interesting.
So, so the Christian doctrine, the Christian belief is that Jesus was a perfect human being.
Right.
He was sinless. We don't think he was some kind of a phantom or a ghost. We think he had a real human body, he had a real human soul, and he was 100% God, right? That's called the hypostatic union. That's who God is. That's who Jesus was. 100% God, 100% man, right? But he was a man.
Right? Yeah.
So the question becomes, how does Jesus come into the existence of human beings and actually become a human being and submit to being a human being the way the rest of us have existed and not have sin?
Mm.
I think that traditionism helps us with this. So when you think about how we've all inherited sin from Adam, how it's infected all of us, how death has spread to all men, Adam is the reason that we physically and spiritually are infected with sin. Our body and our soul is messed up. Depravity, right?
Yeah.
So because all human beings were present in the seed of Adam, like Levi was present in Abraham.
Right.
Okay? Just like that, we were all present in Adam at the time of the fall, and so we inherited sin as Adam procreated more kids after the fall. So according to this view, all human beings aren't just like legally guilty. It's not like he was our representative and he screwed it up for us.
Yeah.
But we were somewhat present in him, culpable in him for this sin, participated with him in the sin, like Levi participated with Abram in giving the tithe.
Yeah.
Right? Mm-hmm. So that makes some sense that we're guilty, that we are infected right from the get-go. I want to read to you two verses from Romans 5. And you should read Romans 5, I think it's verse 12 through like 21, because it talks about this second Adam thesis, how we have inherited sin and death through the first Adam, but then Jesus, the second Adam, came along, and his death can atone for our sin and give grace and eternal life. It's a really cool passage, but I just want to read two verses out of it. Romans 5:12 and Romans 5:15. Verse 12 says, "Therefore, just as through one man sin entered into the world, and death spread through sin, and so death spread to all men because all sinned." Okay?
Yeah.
So death came through one man and spread to all people because all had sinned. Verse 15 of Romans 5 says, "For if by the transgression of the one the many died, much more did the grace of God and the gift by the mercy of the one man, Jesus Christ, abound to many. But you see that by the one transgression, many died.
Yeah.
And then
yeah.
it's saying much more by this act of righteousness can the many be made alive, can the many be saved, right? This is awesome. What I think is crazy about this verse is that it says Adam is responsible for sin entering into the world, not Eve.
Yeah, yeah.
It was through Adam that sin entered the world. It was through Adam that death spread to all people.
Yeah, well, that's all over Scripture.
Eve. Yeah. Well, mm-hmm. but it's weird because Eve was the first one to sin, wasn't she? Wasn't she the one who ate from the fruit?
That's what happened.
And then Adam ate after her. Mm-hmm. So why is it through Adam? And I think that when you go back and you do a careful reading of the first three chapters of the Bible, mm-hmm. the reason is because God gave the command to Adam before he even created Eve.
Yeah.
God didn't give the command to Eve. I'm not saying she was allowed to eat from it, but the responsibility was on Adam, and he completely failed.
Yeah.
So sin enters through Adam, not through Eve. Death spread to all through Adam. So here is an idea I have, and I know some other theologians who believe this, and I wouldn't die for this necessarily, but I'm pretty sure it makes sense. You ready?
Let's hear it. Let's okay. go.
I think that sin is transmitted in our species through the males. If death spread to us through Adam, how does it continue to transmit through our species? I don't think it's transmitted from females. I think it's transmitted from males, which means that if any of us have a dad,
yeah.
which we all do, we've been infected because that's where sin is transmitted.
Yeah.
Physically, I think, and spiritually, I think. So yeah, all of us have right. sin. It's not passed on from the mom, although all of our moms have sin. Because they had dads, mm-hmm. it's passed on from the dad. So every person who has a physical dad, which is everybody except Jesus, has sin transmitted to them. And I think that that is what Romans 5:12 is teaching, that this is how death and sin are spread.
Yeah, so yeah.
Jesus' virgin birth is necessary in order for Jesus not to inherit sin nature from a human father. It's not just some cute idea or fun mythological story. It is a necessity for him to be born without getting infected with transmitted or inherited sin.
Yes, yes.
So this allowed That's Jesus exactly to right. be born in a state of innocence like Adam and Eve were born in a state of innocence. That he mm-hmm. he had the ability not to give in to sin. He wasn't born into it. He wasn't infected with it from the get-go.
Yeah, and another idea that like this theology implies that I just thought of is that you would also have to realize that Jesus had to be born of a virgin because he wasn't created. Mm-hmm. So if Joseph and Mary had sex to conceive Jesus, then he would be a created
His
being.
His soul would have been created.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So he had to come through a virgin because he's not a created being.
He did pre-exist his earthly existence. That's a good
yeah.
point. Yeah.
Yeah. So you would have to think about that. Like he pre-existed because he's God. So he couldn't have been created. Therefore, yeah. like he wasn't conceived.
Yeah,
that's why he had to come as a virgin.
So, and that's what Philippians talks about, how he took on flesh. He didn't lose anything.
Yeah.
He added something, which is interesting. So I think that this is important for the virgin birth thing. I don't think it's just a folklore story. I think it's necessity that he was born of a virgin in order to be able to be sinless. And yeah. that's why he's the second Adam, because he literally is in the same
that's right.
state Adam was, mm-hmm. and Adam screwed it up. But yeah. Jesus came and he fulfilled it and didn't screw mm-hmm. up.
So when we're under Jesus and when we believe in him, we're under his seed. We
yes.
inherited what he did.
Yeah, and that's the whole point, man, is we yeah. need a new heredity. Mm-hmm. I need a new lineage. And if I, and that's why, Tyler, this is fascinating. That's why Jesus says you have to be born again.
Yes, exactly.
Because in our first birth, we were infected. But through being born again, we can have his lineage, his righteousness, his perfection, his sacrifice cleanse us.
Yeah.
I think it's just fascinating, all the theological implications.
There's so much to this.
Yeah,
it's
really beautiful.
Well, the more you think about it and go through Scripture and see this, the more it makes sense
it
to
does.
Me.
It does. Yeah. It makes a ton of sense.
Yeah. And so not only does the Isaiah 7:14 passage prophecy specifically mention the virgin birth, but the oldest prophecy about the coming Messiah alludes to it as well.
Yeah, and people miss this a lot. Yeah. This is really cool.
People really do. And so I'm going to read that prophecy. It's from Genesis 3, 14 and 15.
Wait a second. You're saying the oldest prophecy about the Messiah comes from Genesis 3?
Yes, yes. Okay. And now this is talked about a lot, but not in this context.
Okay, let's see what you got.
Yeah, so it says, "The Lord God said to the serpent, 'Because you have done this, cursed are you more than all the cattle and more than every beast of the field. On your belly you will go, and dust you will eat all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise you on the head, and you shall bruise him on the heel.'" Now notice,
okay.
First thing, notice that this curse on the serpent promises that there will be enmity between the serpent and the woman, but between the serpent's seed and her seed, the woman's seed. So it's saying seed singular.
Yeah, seed and seed, not seeds.
Not seeds, plural. Yeah. So what does that mean? Seed is singular, not plural. This is speaking of a specific seed to come from the woman, right?
So not just her descendants or her ancestors. Well, why doesn't it say between the man? Like,
exactly.
Why is it specific about is it going to be enmity between the woman and you?
That's the question,
why not
right?
The man and you.
Oh, so maybe this is the gotcha passage, right? It breaks down our theology. See, clearly sin is passed on from the woman, right? Like seat of whatever. It not passed on from the man. So that's the question. When we talk about procreation, seed usually refers to what the man contributes. So this passage is weird. So, but
this is weird. Yeah, the seed, usually you say like a man contributes a seed or spills his seed. I think even the Bible talks about that in other places.
It does.
But the woman provides the egg, right?
Yeah.
And the man provides the fertilization.
Yeah, when we're talking physical seed.
That's how we talk about it.
It is, exactly.
Yeah, but what is a woman's seed?
That's the question, exactly. Yeah. So, but the truth is, Jesus did not come through the line of man, but he was the seed of woman, right? And that's what we just talked about.
Yeah, he didn't come through man. He came from a woman.
He was from Mary. Mm-hmm. So that was from the woman. Only Mary, yeah. So he was, this was God prophesying, saying, like, the seed of the woman is going to come to you and destroy you, essentially.
Yeah.
That's what's happening.
Yeah.
So this is huge. And
there's a prophecy of the virgin birth.
Yeah.
In Genesis 3:15.
It is. And this supports this theological concept, right? Mm-hmm. That he had to be sinless, right? By coming from the woman, which is her seed.
Yeah, that's fascinating.
Yeah, so this is all kind of tying in together, if you guys can see this. It's so important to note that because Jesus did not come through the line of man, but he came through the woman's seed.
You could even say that Jesus is the only human being ever that could be called the seed of woman.
He is.
If what we mean by that is not man.
Of course, yeah.
He's the only seed of woman without man.
The only one who came from a woman,
Came exclusively.
Exclusively
from a woman.
Is what I mean, yeah.
So that is fascinating. And again, a lot of people see this as talking about Jesus, but you can also see this as implying virgin birth.
Yeah, that's
right.
So
it's not like this is some made-up thing later in time. It seems like from the very beginning when Moses wrote these words down that this was the promise of what was going to happen.
Yeah, it's interesting, too. You see at creation, a woman came exclusively from a man, but then now through Jesus, a man came exclusively through a woman. It's very interesting. So,
and he's the second Adam.
And he is.
She came from the first Adam. Second Adam came from her. Yeah.
It's so fascinating.
So much there. It is. It's cool. And so with all of that, what we want you to see, and again, I hope this was kind of new to you.
Yeah.
This is not your typical Christmas episode.
No, it's not. Yeah, like usually we talk about like prophecy and stuff like that about around Christmas time, but this is important.
This is important.
We need to know
about why is the virgin birth necessary? And so that's where, like, as a Christian, if you're like, oh, that virgin birth thing, I don't know about it, it's kind of needed in order for Jesus to be who he was.
Yeah, it really
is. It's needed for him to be the second Adam who was born in a state of innocence, who didn't have to give in to sin, but live perfectly.
Yes.
And that's what the virgin birth is all about. And he did that in order to redeem us. So he is a human being because he comes from a human being.
Yeah, of course.
But he's not in the same sinful state or infected with the same sin nature as we are. So I hope this has been encouraging to you and a new slant on the virgin birth stuff at Christmas.
Yeah,
and I hope you've been driving around extra, thinking about other gifts you can buy because you wanted to listen to this whole episode. I don't know. But share with your friends. Let people know about this. Traducianism is a fascinating topic to study. And if you want more info about it, any systematic theology book you can get your hands on will talk about this. This isn't a new concept. This has been around in Christian circles for thousands of years.
Yeah, you would think it's a new concept because this isn't talked about
a
lot.
It's not, no.
So you would think we just pulled this out of our, like
out
just
of our what?
Yeah. our butts. No, there you go. I said it. No,
yeah, but so it's not. Yeah. It's an old idea. And that's been around a very long time, but we hope it's encouraging to you. We hope it makes you think differently about humanity. We hope it makes you more in awe of God for the amazing capability he gave us to procreate human bodies and human souls, and that we would take that responsibility seriously, and that we'd see the virgin birth in a new light. But hey, listen, again, if you liked this episode, please go rate us on iTunes or Apple Podcast.
Yeah.
Review us on there. Write us a note. If you have any questions about any of the things we've said or about topics you'd like to know more about, shoot us an email or an instant message or a direct message or any of those things on all of our social media. We'd love to answer your questions. We love interacting with people out there. And hopefully we can get to a lot of these questions that people have asked us.
Yes.
Lastly, if you would like to support us, if you found benefit from this ministry, you can support us on patreon.com/ Christ Culture Coffee.
Yeah, that's right.
We'd love for you to go do that, and then there's some perks and there's some extra stuff
you can find. Yeah, and you want an easy way to get to it, too. You could go to our Instagram profile. We have a link in our bio, so if you want to go there, that's a really easy way to access it. That way you don't have to type in the link individually.
Yep.
So please do that, and you could also check out the link in general, because there's some cool stuff that we're offering to those who are supporters, like these new stone mugs that we're very excited about.
Yeah, they're so sweet.
Yeah, yeah. So so you definitely want to get one of those. They're super cool. So please, if you are in a place where you can support us, we would greatly appreciate that. It would help this ministry go further. So thank you guys so much for joining us on this episode in Christ, Culture, and Coffee. We will see you guys next week.
Have a Merry Christmas.